Finally tonight, a treasure trove of presidential recordings. Richard Nixon may have had the most famous secret taping system in the White House, but his was not the first. In 1962, John F. Kennedy installed his own, capturing conversations with his advisors, world leaders, former presidents, and even with his family. He began taping just before the Cuban Missile Crisis, when the U.S. and the Soviet Union went up to the brink of nuclear war. This week marks the 50th anniversary of that standoff. Tense conversations from those 13 days are among the transcripts and CDs in the new book, Listening In, The Secret White House Recordings of John F. Kennedy. Ted Widmer, director and librarian of Brown University, sorted through the material and annotated it. Gwen Ifill recently sat down with him.
Ted Widmer, thank you so much for joining us. Tell us a little bit about these tapes. What's the provenance of them? Where do they come from?
Well, he decided to start taping in the summer of 1962, which is an interesting moment. He's about halfway through his presidency, and we don't know why exactly. Our main source of information is an oral history left by a man named Robert Bauck, who was a Secret Service agent who installed the tapes. And from that, we know where he placed the mics around the Oval Office and the Cabinet Room, and we know that his secretary, Evelyn Lincoln, was in the know and stored the tapes, but almost no one else knew at the time. And in fact, it wasn't until 1973 that the world learned that they existed. The day after Alexander Butterfield famously revealed the Nixon tapes, the then head of the Kennedy Library, which was not yet even a building, revealed that there were Kennedy tapes also. But it has taken a long time for them to become fully cleared and available.
And just to be clear, nobody else knew about that they were being taped, that they were being recorded.
That's
only
right.
The president was aware that he was the one pushing the button.
Even top advisors like Ted Sorensen claimed to be dumbfounded when he learned that the tapes existed.
Let's walk through some of the key moments in John F. Kennedy's presidency that these tapes capture. One of them was the Cuban Missile Crisis, very interesting trove of information. And we want to listen to one part. And the voices you hear are Arthur Landahl, a CIA expert on mapping and aerial photography, and Sidney Graybeal, a CIA Russian expert. And they're all talking to the president about what they're seeing there.
How far advanced is this?
Sir, we've never seen this kind of an installation before.
Even in the Soviet Union?
No, sir. From May of 69, we've never had any YouTube coverage of the Soviet Union, so we do not know what kind of a practice it would use in connection with.
How do you know this is a medium-range ballistic missile?
The length, sir.
The what?
The length. Yes.
The length of the missile.
The unknown factor here, sir, is the degree to which the equipment has been checked out after it's been shipped from the Soviet Union here. It's arranged the equipment. If the equipment is checked out, the site has to be accurately surveyed. Position has to know. Once this is known, then you're talking a matter of hours.
What was it like to watch something like this, a big historical moment, unfold in real time?
Well, you sit on the edge of your seat listening, as I'm sure people were doing in 1962. It's uncanny that he started taping just before the crisis. But the result is we have a nearly perfect record of all of the meetings and what people were saying and their shifting opinions. So it's very important for historians that we have these tapes. And this is the very first meeting. It's the meeting on October 16th. 1962, when he's seeing the pictures for the first time, and he's shocked because they contradict what the Russians have been saying, and everything he understands about the world, the very complicated world picture, is upset at that moment.
Another important part of a short presidency with a lot of moments is the civil rights moment, the civil rights crisis, when civil rights leaders came to his office and they talked to him about what they expected of the Kennedy presidency, but also he found himself in a difficult position in trying to manage what was unfolding in Mississippi at the time of the integration of University of Mississippi with James Meredith. In this little piece of tape, we hear him talking to the then governor of Mississippi, Ross Barnett.
We couldn't consider moving Meredith if we haven't been able to restore order outside. That's the problem, Governor.
Well, I'll tell you what I'll do, Mr. President.
Yeah.
I'll go up there myself.
Well, now, how long will it take you to get there?
And I'll get a microphone and tell them that you have agreed to be removed.
Now, wait a minute. Governor. Now, how long is it going to take you to get up there?
About an hour.
Now, I tell you what, if you want to go up there, then you call me from up there, and then we'll decide what we're going to do before you make any speeches about it.
Well, all right.
There's no sense in that.
Whatever you do.
See, we got an hour to go, and that's not, we may not have an hour.
Governor Barnett clearly had a different idea about how to handle this crisis than President Kennedy did.
Absolutely. And that's the key moment. And sometimes you can tell more from the intonations than from the words themselves. And President Kennedy is raising his voice a little and saying, I'm in charge here and you're not. And the governor backs down. They're each trying to work with the other. They're trying to save face a little bit and not let this thing get out of hand. But at that moment, JFK really takes control of the situation.
Governor Barnett wanted James Meredith removed because he thought that he was the source of the problem?
Yes. And President Kennedy thought if he were removed, he might be vulnerable to the mobs that were around the jail. And he just didn't trust Governor Barnett to maintain order. There's a lot of talk of keeping order in that call. But that is the moment where the sometimes sluggish Kennedy administration decides that civil rights is a major priority, and it never looked back after that.
The other interesting section, and there's lots in this book that is not on the audio tapes that come with it, but still another interesting part that I found curious was when he talks toward the end, he reflects on his presidency. And it turns out to be 10 days before he's assassinated. Let's listen to some of his thoughts. This was into his dictaphone.
Right.
Politically, the news is somewhat disturbing, looking towards 64, the election in Texas on the poll tax, the Republican meeting in Charleston, South Carolina, which the Republicans were more optimistic than usual about the South.
It had only been a year earlier, in a month or two, since the Mississippi crisis, and they had come a very long way. They had put civil rights at the top of the agenda. He'd called it a moral crisis. He'd called on all Americans to move past the divisions of the past. But as a result, he was in some danger of losing states in the South, and he'd won by so narrow a margin in 1960 that re-election was not a foreordained conclusion. So he's a little bit worried looking ahead, and he's got foreign policy problems and a difficult Congress that didn't, including Democrats who didn't always want to work with him. So he had his work cut out for him. And that's an interesting moment because his voice is a little more fragile than at other. I mean, throughout these meetings, he's very decisive, very much in command, even in times of great difficulty. And in this moment, very near the end, there's a fragile human quality.
Why did it take 10 years for us to learn of the existence of the tapes, 1973, and then 50 years for us to actually see them in this form?
Well, some have been released. The Kennedy Library has been releasing them to scholars since 1983 in targeted batches by theme. So the Cuban Missile Crisis tapes were released. Certain civil rights tapes were released. But it takes time to go through the vast extent of these tapes, and they need to be cleared by representatives of the federal government to make sure that there are no national security secrets being released.
And also by the family.
And by the family. And it just takes time to do it right. But in the last couple of years, the library has really done an extraordinary thing by making the last batch available, by finishing the process, but by putting a huge amount of it online for Americans to hear. So it's really a remarkable chance for the American people to hear what it is like to be president in a very visceral way.
Very visceral way. It's fascinating to listen to. Name of the book is Listening In, The Secret White House Recordings of John F. Kennedy. Ted Widmer, thanks for listening to them all for us.
Thank you, Gwen.
And online, you can listen to more of the Kennedy recordings from the JFK Library website. Find a link on our homepage.